Let it snow. Ow! She bounced, bounced, bounced. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the Geo Institute's final live stream of 2022. I'm Brad Keeler, the director of the Geo Institute, and you are watching the second in our series of Geo-Congress sneak previews. I hope that you are starting to get excited for Geo-Congress 2023, which is going to be in Los Angeles from March 26th to 29th. It is going to be a big deal. We think we're going to have our biggest exhibit hall ever. We think we're going to have our biggest attendance ever, and we want you to be there to be a part of it. So head on over to geocongress.org, check out all the information there, and maybe register while you're there. Your company want to sponsor? We can handle that too. You can do all kinds of things. If you are here and you don't know anything about the Geo Institute, after you watch this today, you should head over to geoinstitute.org, where you will find out that we are a technical society with about 12,000 members, most of whom are geotechnical engineers and/or geologists, and we are part of the American Society of Civil Engineers. If you are still looking for that last holiday gift for an engineer that you know, join the 96 Club. Contribute $96 or more to GI student programs, and you will get a Carl Terzaghi bobblehead of your very own to display as you wish in your living space or your working space. Sneak preview number two. We are really excited to have with us Buka Nweke from the University of Southern California. And here to tell you a little bit more about what Buka is going to say today is LA Chapter Past Chair Dave Albus. Dave, thanks for being here and take it away.
Thanks, Brad. You always have such an exciting lead-in. Yeah, so yes, I'm Dave Albus of Albus & Associates. We're in Anaheim, California. It's a geotechnical firm, and we're near the famous Disneyland and Angels baseball team, just right down the street from me. And as Brad said, I'm the past chair of the Geo Institute, and I stepped down from that so I could now serve on the committee for the 2023 Geo Congress for next year. And I want to say we are very excited to host Geo Congress in LA. We're going to have some presenters discussing some very interesting projects and content that's particular to Southern California as well as global topics. So you're not going to want to miss this event. So it's my great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Chukwuebuka Nweke. Oh, I think I botched that up, but we all call him Buka. And he's a professor of civil engineering at the University of Southern California, Viterbi School of Engineering. And he directs the N.E.S.T Research Group, where his research is focused on solving problems at the intersection of geotechnical engineering, earthquake engineering, seismology, and geomorphology. Some of his investigation topics include characterizing sedimentary basin effects and the earthquake hazards, evaluation of physics-based earthquake simulations for the purpose of analyzing associated hazards, and improving infrastructure resiliency. And lastly, investigating the mechanical behavior of biocemented soils to establish sustainable alternatives for mitigation of hazards. Professor Nweke earned his PhD and MS in civil engineering and environmental engineering at the University of California, Berkeley, and his BS in civil and environmental engineering at the University of California, Davis. After the completion of his graduate studies, Professor Nweke was an NSF AHIP postdoctoral research fellow in the civil and environmental engineering department at the University of California, Los Angeles. But prior to his current position, he was a practicing engineering consultant for NGO, who's a geotechnical and environmental engineering firm here. So Dr. Nweke will be discussing the effects of sedimentary basins on seismic ground response. A sedimentary basin is essentially a geologic condition wherein we have alluvial and sedimentary rocks that are present in a depression of a stiffer basement rock. And because of the thickness and material properties that vary across the basin, three-dimensional effects factor into ground response. The seismic waves are often trapped and reflected due to the interactions with these deeper materials. So this condition sets up an interaction of surface waves with body waves, which leads to a stronger ground motion that might otherwise happen. Dr. Nweke will discuss his work on the use of actual site response recordings to investigate the effects of basin factors and the effectiveness of differing model procedures for predicting the basin effects. He will also discuss the site-to-site component of the within-event variability for basin and non-basin sites, which is useful for hazard analysis. So with that, I'm going to turn the show over to Dr. Nweke, and we'll listen to his presentation.
Awesome. Thank you guys for having me. I really appreciate it. I'm going to try and share my presentation now. If you give me a quick second. Nope, I'm not updating right now. And I'm going to, how do I do this? Presenter stand, nope. Wait. I have to find a way to present just the presentation. There we go. I see it. And there we go. All right. Does everybody see my screen?
Looking good.
It just came up.
Go for it.
Everybody sees the screen, just the screen, not the presenter mode, but the presentation.
You got it. Yep.
All right. So, good morning, everybody. It's wonderful being here. For those of you who have joined us, thank you for joining us. Today, I'm going to talk about seismic site response in Southern California sedimentary basins. The reason why we're doing this is because Southern California Geo-Congress is in LA, so we're going to try to explain this and have some fun. So just to jump right into it, you know, the first question that you have to ask is, what is site response? You know, there's a couple of different ways you can define site response, but this is what I'm going to define it. And essentially, it's the alteration of seismic energy due to variations in the properties in the subsurface geologic material, i.e. sediments or rocks. These site response can be influenced by a variety of physical mechanisms, right? This includes impedance and dampening effects, where you have amplification due to contrast in the subsurface from going from stiffer to solid. You have resonance effects, where you have, you know, depending on the earthquake, the frequency of the earthquake, the energy of the earthquake, some buildings may shake a little less, some buildings may shake a little more. So it depends on what you have. And if you have a, if you put a bowl of jello on the short one, it's going to be fine. That middle one, not so much, right? Then you also have topographic effects. You know, some people say it's a little lonely at the top. Well, in this case, depending on where you are, you can have some amplification due to topographic effects. And then you also have the typical basin effects, which is what Dave spoke about, which is the 2D and 3D effects that happen from interactions of these seismic waves with subsurface materials. So what is site response? Why is it important? Well, it's important because of natural hazards. I'm sure you're well aware, for earthquakes, we have, you know, the Gorka earthquake in Nepal. You have the destruction of pretty much infrastructure spatially over wide regions. Here you see a building next door that crumbled completely, one that got damaged but didn't crumble completely. Why is that the case? Site response has a lot to do with that. Yeah, fault surface rupture from the Ridgecrest earthquake. Site response has some stuff to do with that. And I'm sure you guys all know the famous picture of the car that was swallowed up from Christchurch. And this is soil liquefaction. And also site response has a lot to do with these as well. So we talk about why it's important and what it is. So why should we care? Well, if you look over the past 60 years, we see that the total population of the planet has been kind of growing linearly. And you see, we've already eclipsed 8 billion, you know, that chart is kind of touching it almost. You know, this is 2022. We've pretty much eclipsed 8 billion. But what you want to notice here is that the blue line, which is the urban population, is increasing at a much higher rate, almost kind of exponentially, where we have this massive shift to the urban population as we move forward in the future. And why this is important is because the more people you have in urban environments, the more people are residing in these critical or close to these critical infrastructures. These critical infrastructures, that we like to build our infrastructure in places where it looks beautiful, but not the greatest geologically. So you have hurricanes, earthquakes, and the likes. And because of that, the more people in the urban population, more infrastructure, more people, you have more risk. And your safety becomes an issue and performance becomes an issue. So how do we characterize these risks and these hazards? Well, the first thing we do is that we have to essentially characterize the hazard first, properly. And that's going to be the primary focus of what we'll be talking about today. The goal is to properly characterize the hazard. After you characterize the hazard, you kind of want to have some kind of relationship between the hazard and the hazard demand and the probability of failure, and that's the fragility. And you combine those two with some level of exposure, and it gives you a level of risk. Today, we're going to focus again, as I said, on the characterization of the hazard. So the outline of our talk today is going to go over what is a basin, how do basins affect ground motions, the ground motion database that we use to do the analysis, the analysis itself, and then some future research, right? So we'll jump into it. What is a basin? Well, as Dave said earlier, a basin essentially is a depression of the Earth's surface filled by deep deposits of soft sediments that are decreasing thickness towards their margin. So they're thicker in the middle and they're shallow on the sides. So you can imagine this beautiful Picasso drawing I have right here. It's just this, you know, a hilly area. And then over time, geologic time, you have this filling of that basin. So in regards to that, there's a lot of different kinds of basins. You know, there's a lot of ways you can define a basin. You have sag basins, interior sag basins, you have graben-type basins, you have rip zone basins, you even have basins formed by strike slip faulting, pull apart, and wrench basins. This is just to show that basins, just like human beings, are individual and unique, and there's no two basins that are alike. So it's very important to know that when we're going into this work. So in Southern California, the reason why we pick Southern California, why Southern California is such a phenomenal place, is because we, one, have a significant amount of geologic variability in Southern California. What you're seeing here, to point out the first thing, is the orange outlines or outlines of the primary basins in Southern California that we've identified. You have the Los Angeles Basin, the San Gabriel Basin, San Fernando Basin, Ventura Basin, Chino Basin, San Bernardino Basin, and there are a few others. Well, these are the primary ones that we're going to focus on. In addition to that, not only do we have the variety of basins adjacent to non-basins, you see a lot of mountains over here and smaller valleys, you also have a significant wealth of recording stations, right? So we have a lot of recording stations here, and all these recording stations have been categorized into these different features. You have, you know, the red circles for basins, the purple triangles for mountains and non-basins, then the yellow triangles for valleys, the green triangles for basin edges. So it just gives you an idea of the four categories that we use. And these categories, essentially, just briefly, is that we have, you know, basins are places that are pretty wide, flat areas. Basin edges are along the margins. Valleys are essentially smaller basins. And the mountain hills, if you're on a mountain, you're not in the basin. So that's kind of the category that we use. So how do these basins affect ground motion? Well, here, what I'm showing here is a spatial map of the intensity measure for PGV for the famous Mexico City earthquake in 1985, also the Michoacan earthquake. And what you see is at the epicenter, you see this radiation and this an attenuation of intensity as you get away. So the energy is supposed to reduce as you get further and further. But we see Mexico City over here, just to the top right of the map, also has a hot spot. And the reason for this, even though this was about 400 kilometers away, we still have this amplification of the ground ground motion intensity. What this is telling you is that there is some kind of effect going there, some kind of site response going there. And unfortunately for Mexico City, it was built on an ancient lake bed. And that ancient lake bed essentially had enough material to essentially amplify the ground motion and essentially devastate buildings to mid to high rise levels, right? So this is essentially an example of quote unquote basin effects. Then what I'm showing here now is an example of basin effects for simulation on the Puente Hills fault. What you'll see is that this was done by Rob Graves. You're gonna see a simulation of an earthquake, and you're gonna watch the ground velocity as it propagates from the earthquake source through the basin and out into the ocean. And you will see a massive intensity. So this is LA. USC is not too far from where the epicenter is. You see, as soon as it gets into the basin, you see this hot color, these very red colors come about. And that's just showing essentially what is close to be a basin effect, right? And you see it as it propagates out. Same thing here in Nepal. So in Nepal, what I'm going to show you here is a video of a location during the Gorkha earthquake. And I'm going to show you the GPS movements of two stations. One of the purple station will be the mountain station, the non-basin, and the gold station will be in the basin, which is where this video has been taken. And you can watch the two and how they co-locate, and you'll see that the purple station goes and it shakes, but it doesn't shake as much. And then the gold station is going to keep going and shaking, and the amplification is going to increase. And this is for the same exact earthquake. And you can see what happens if you look at the video as the basin is shaking back and forth. The people could barely walk. You know, it seems like a coordinated Michael Jackson video here. Fortunately, in this situation, nobody passed away in this particular video, but many people lost their lives due to these basin effects and the devastation from this earthquake. And this is just to highlight again how basin effects affect ground motion. So when we look at it from an engineering standpoint, how do we essentially decipher how we account for these different features? So the first thing we do is, you know, we have an area like this. The area on the right can be the Los Angeles Basin. The left can be the San Fernando Basin, and there's a fault in there. And then you have an earthquake that happens. So that's the source component. You know, it's a function of the magnitude and the style of faulting. Then you have some kind of path. And that path essentially attenuates the ground motion. It's the function of the distance and the material between there. And then from there, you have this the behavior of the energy, the seismic energy with the sediments. You have the vertical propagating body waves, you have focusing, and then you have this shallow site response combined with this deep site response. But then you also have another situation where you can have, because of the incidence angle, you can have the same waves that occur, but in addition to that, you can have this reflection and refraction that occurs that can lead to the propagation of surface waves, which add even further amplification to the ground motion for your particular site. So, and this is what we respond to as the basin response, right? So one thing I want to point out is that in 2018, in the National Seismic Hazard Maps, the USGS incorporated these basin effects in a couple of basins, and what they found was a 50% increase in essentially in the intensities that they predicted for those regions. That's a significant amount. So that same 50% of that energy was captured that wasn't captured before. And this new model that's coming in 2022, we have an updated model that we'll talk about today as well, right? So when we go back into the basin effects mechanism, we pay attention to this. The way we do it is in engineering is we split it up into the earthquake source term plus the wave path term plus the site term. And that gives us some mean prediction of the intensity measure with an error and a standard deviation. So that's how we do it from the engineering standpoint. So in the modeling standpoint, we represent those site response features with these parameters, VS30 basin depth, which I'm sure some of you are familiar with. And that we combine that with the ground motion models, and that gives us some level estimate of site response. This representation of site response is what we call ergodic, because this is a globally averaged model. We straighten in space for time. Another thing we can do is we can look into doing ground motion analysis, you know, deep soil, shake, or you can do simulations. And essentially using a shear velocity profile instead of a parameter. And this gives you a different estimate of site response for the same site. And this is called a non-ergodic approach. It's more of a site-specific approach. Today, we're going to kind of look at something that's kind of in the middle, going towards a non-ergodic, which is a regionally adjusted ergodic approach going towards a non-ergodic and how we're going to look at stuff. So for basin modeling, which we talk about basin, for basin modeling, what we look at primarily, we're going to focus on the site component, right? So we have the VS30 that I told you about and the basin depth. The VS30 gives us a representation of the stiffness of the site, and the basin depth gives us a sense of the scale and the depth of the site, right? But the VS30 gives us the first order scaling of the site. So it's telling you, you know, with a function of period, this is the amplification you're going to get in your ground motion for a given VS30. The basin depth gives us a second order scaling, which is that in addition to that VS30 scaling, the basin depth tells you that if you're in a thicker basin or a shallower basin, you're going to have some level of amplification or slightly de-amplification relative to that amplification that we had from the VS30. So this is important because in order to capture these, this is essentially telling us that when we added this feature of this basin depth, we can essentially resolve more of the data, more of the information that's within the data. So we can predict or develop models that can estimate these features and properly characterize the hazard and not underpredict these earthquakes, right? So the way we do it is we have to essentially make a relationship between VS30 and Z1 to quantify this basin depth. And the reason why we do this relationship is because there is some relationship between VS30 and basin depth, as you can imagine, and you don't want to create models with, you know, parameters that are correlated. So we have to essentially normalize these things and center it to essentially mitigate that correlation. That's what we're doing here by essentially developing this mean model, which we can then make a parameter, this we call the depth differential, which tells us or indicates to us whether you're thicker or shallower from a particular average basin depth. And that's what we use, and we relate that to the site response with site effect. And from there, we're able to determine, okay, if you're greater than, if you're a positive depth differential, you have some amplification. If you're negative, you have some depth amplification. Now, going over this, just to let you know, as I've been saying all this stuff, I haven't told you if this model essentially, or this approach tells you if you're in the basin or not. So you can essentially apply this to anywhere. You can apply this to the mountains, in the basins, shoot, even the ocean, right? So that's a subtle limitation of the current approach at the time. So now that we have more data, we have more information, we can improve the models, and our goal is to essentially use that the maps that I showed you earlier to essentially decipher what's in the basin and what's not in the basin, and see that how that affects this site response. And that's what we're going to get into shortly. You can also look at the 3D site response from some simulations that I want to show you here. I won't dive too deep into this today, but know that this is out there as well. So in order for us to do our analysis, we have to essentially gather data. So NGOS2 project that essentially ended in 2010 was able to grab and accumulate ground motion data from 1940 to about 2010. And that ended up being about 317 events in Southern California, about 15,000 recordings. Since 2010, a lot more data has been processed and added to the our database, and we've added just about 25% more of the events, but we've essentially doubled the number of recordings. This is for a couple of reasons. The number of stations have increased, the number of the improvement in sensors has been significant, and this is a kind of like a team effort between a lot of organizations, CGS, UAGS, and many other people, and this data is essentially growing, and we're essentially beginning the preparations for NGOS3. So this data is actually growing as we speak. So, but this is the data we collected. We collected more data. So now we have more recordings per site, which means we have a better efficacy of our resolution of site effects. And that's what we want. So now we look at the analysis of the ground motion. And the overview of this essentially is that, remember, I told you that the mean, the ground motion models give you some kind of a mean and an error and a variability. So we want to see how knowledge of being in the basin and not in the basin affects this mean and this variability. Particularly with the variability, you want to see how it affects the variability associated with the site, which is the within event variability, which are those. So we're going to talk about that as we go forward, right? So let's jump into the analysis. I'm not going to go too deep into the nuts and bolts because of time limits. So I'm just going to give you a top of the cloud view of it, and we're going to go through. So the overview and the scope is using earthquake data. You know, when we gather all that information, that data, we have to essentially compute intensity measures from the data, the PSA, the PGAs, and all that stuff. Once we do that, then we perform residual analysis, where the residual is taken as difference between, in log units, between the observation minus the ground motion model. And that residual, essentially, what the residual tells you is, given the features that you put in your model, it's telling you whatever residual is what your model is not capturing. So our goal is to see how well our model is not capturing, or how well the model is capturing or not capturing the site response, and relate that to basins to see how we can further improve that. And that's our goal. And once we perform the residual analysis, we have to partition the residuals. In order to isolate those features, we have to remove the residuals that are related to the components of the event, as I said before, and the components of the site. And the event terms are just like that. And once we remove the components from the event terms, we can get the within event residual. And what is the event term? The event term essentially is the difference between a particular event and the global average. So overall, for all the magnitudes, for example, you have all these magnitude fives all over the world. So they have an average distribution. So, but if you put a particular event from anywhere in the world, it's probably going to have some offset from that average. That offset is the event term. So you can have a negative or a positive event term. So we want to remove those event-related components so we can isolate just the components that the contributions from to the residual that's coming from the site. And that's what we do. And when we get that, we essentially use partition out the site component. And then we kind of review, or we observe or assess these site terms with respect to basic parameters to essentially go about and do our analysis. So that's what we're going to do in the upcoming slides. And again, just when we do this, your model, you don't want to include the features that you're trying to assess. So the current model has an older basin model, as I showed you. We want to see how the new basin model is going to perform, so we don't include that feature within our model so that we can see it captured in the residual and then assess it using more data. So when we do that, we have what I'm showing you here, which is the site terms as a function of period. So this is the mean of the site terms within those different categories, basin, non-basin, and the valleys. So if you see, the blue line is all the data together, which should be essentially close to zero because they're all averaging out. You're not accounting for if you're in a basin or not, so everything should cancel each other out and it should be pretty much flat. However, when you take the opportunity to essentially separate these site terms for basin and non-basin, you see different things pop up. For instance, the gold line is showing sites that are in a basin. And what that is telling you is that we have a positive residual. A positive residual, if you remember, means that the data is much larger than the model. So the model is under-predicting the data. So in this case, at long periods, we have a lot of features of the data that we're not capturing within these basins. The same thing for the smaller basins. At shorter periods, we have a lot that we're not capturing. And also at longer periods, for the smaller basins, we're overestimating those portions. And this makes sense, right? So Long periods is kind of like, you can imagine the waves that are required to essentially affect the basin are much longer. So in order for you to have an under prediction at long periods, you have to be a larger basin. To have it at short periods, you have to be a smaller basin. So what we're seeing here kind of matches what we expected, and we're excited about that because it means that there's some things that we can update. The purple line essentially is the mountain hills, the non-basin sites, and it's kind of over-predicting, and there's a couple of reasons for that. One of which is, you know, the model is based on the rock residuals, so we might be over-predicting based on those rock residuals, and that's okay. And but again, these are effects that we're planning on looking into, and my group is looking into as we speak. Now, this is just for the categories, but if you remember, one of the things I said in the beginning was that basins are like people, and they're individuals, right? So when we look at individual basins, we see variability as well. So we're going to focus primarily on the long periods here. At the shorter periods, you know, the basin effects are kind of, there's a lot that's kind of going into that, you know, high frequency, low frequency. We're going to focus on the long periods for these basins because that's when the basin effects we're looking at. And we look at these basins, you see the LA basin is kind of the one that's underpredicting the most. But Chino Basin is the one that's overpredicting the most. And what you see is that as you go, for each of these basins, as you go, it gets higher and higher in underprediction, right? And I'll show you in the next slide, but these basins have different sizes. So Chino Basin is kind of the shallowest basin, followed by the Coachella Valley Basin, followed by the San Bernardino Basin. And as you see, there's a relationship between the amount of overprediction or underprediction that we have and the basin size. So that's important to know that even though we have differences between basin and non-basins, we also have within basin differences that we have to account for when we do our analysis, and we have to account for this as well. So keep that in mind. And so next slide I'm going to show you is an example of what these different basins look like. So there are we have these models in Southern California, the community velocity models, which essentially resolve the basin size and the basin shape. And what you're seeing is LA has a significant, which is at the top left, you see it's pretty deep. It's about 8 kilometers deep. So if you look at what I'm showing you here, it's a cross-section, and it's telling you a profile of the shear wave velocity, which is an indication of how stiff the site is. So if you look at the bar at the bottom, the orange yellowish area is about 3 kilometers per second. So that's to tell you that, okay, that's kind of where, if you look at that and say, okay, that's the transition between basins and the basin and the bedrock, that you see the LA basin is kind of like goes all the way to 8 kilometers deep in some places, versus the San Bernardino basin that I showed you that was shallow. Yeah, somebody can say maybe it goes to 3, you know, 1, 2, depending on where you want to draw your line at the yellow line, you know, but it shows you that it's much shallow. Then you look at the Coachella Valley basin to the Imperial Valley basin. If you look at the beginning of that, you see how shallow it is, you know, talking about, you know, about 1 or less, versus the Imperial Valley basin is pretty deep, right? So this is to show you that the reason why we see those differences in the different basins is because of the different shape. And it's just to point that through. Now, I want to go back to what I was talking about with underprediction and overprediction. So what we do now is we want to relate those site terms. We were showing it as a function of period, but now we want to relate them to our basin depth parameter, which is that depth differential that I spoke about. So if you're positive, you're a thicker basin. If you're negative, you're a shallower basin. And what this is showing here is it's showing you that for short periods, PGA, you shouldn't see much of these quote unquote basin effects, right? We typically see, this is for all the data together. So for all the data together, we should essentially see no basin effects. But at longer periods, we should see some kind of feature, right? And what we see at longer periods, at three period of 3 seconds, is that you have some scaling with delta Z, right? So when you get thicker, you have some underprediction. When you get shallow, you have some overprediction. So we relate these, and this is how we essentially develop our model that we put into the ground motion model, right? So relating the basin thickness to some level of amplification. So what this is showing you, and just to give you an example, so let's say you have a site that has a site effect or a site term of about 0.2. So if you do your ground motion analysis for your site, you get a site term of 0.2. Well, if you take this exponential, it says that you're underpredicting by about 22%. So if you were to just do this without incorporating the basin effects in the model, you would underpredict your base shear that you would give your structural engineers by about 22%, which is a problem, right? So that's the importance of why this work is necessary. So when we now look at it, so what we're going to do is look at now is we're going to look at those the site term versus the depth differential for those different categories. In this case here, we have the basin and basin edge combined. And what we're seeing is that there is a scaling, and we have essentially this little to zero deamplification in basins. Why I point this out is because there's been some debate about should we or should we not induce the amplification of the site amplification in basins. And the decision was made not to do so, which was a good decision for basins. However, for the smaller basins, you will see that that's not the case. But what I'm showing here is that there's little to zero the amplification for basins. We also have about amplification or underprediction in basins, about 35% on average in Southern California. And then the effects that we see, and I showed you before, are mainly at long periods, so greater than about 1 second. When we and the scaling that we have, that you see that scaling dependency only comes from the deeper basins, that we call them coastal basins, which is Los Angeles Basin, the San Fernando Basin, the Ventura Basin. And the reason why this is important is to understand that the scaling with parameters per basin is going to vary. So some basins will have some scaling capabilities with the depth differential. Some basins don't. That's not to say there's no basin effect. If you notice here, there's an offset. This plot doesn't go through zero. So there's an offset. So there's a base level of amplification. But what it's saying, if it doesn't have a scaling effect, is that there's no further amplification with depth differential. So essentially the basin has kind of a uniform scaling versus LA Basin. It depends on what side of the basin that you're on, and you're going to have a different level of scaling. Now, when we look at the valleys, we see that the valleys are primarily shallower basin, right? Primarily. And we also have about 22% deamplification, depending on what kind of valley you're in. Some valleys are actually very, you know, have some kind of, you know, they may be small in lateral extent, but they may be deep, you know, it may be a very deep canyon. In that case, you may have some amplification. So, but what this is showing is that these effects are primarily at short periods. So for smaller basins, we have the amplification. So big basins are the amplification, small basins are the amplification. And that's important to know. This is at long periods. And then at short periods, you may have some amplification from that. And we'll see that in an example later. Then when we look at the mountain hills, the non-basins, we see that we have both positive and negative depth differentials. And we have the largest amplification and deamplification. I know some of you are probably saying, it doesn't make any sense. This is basin effects. Well, I never said that this was, I'm comparing basin effects to depth differential. I'm comparing the site response, the site effects to depth differential. And in Southern California, we have these weak rocks. You know, these weak rocks will have some kind of site response related to them. And maybe there's some features in here that's not related to the site response that may be related to topographic effects or discontinuity. So there's a lot that's in here. And this is something that we're looking further into right now in my research group. But the fact that we see this in the data, we also model this as well. And these effects are primarily intermediate periods. So this is just site. I'm comparing what I'm showing here is the site response of the mountain hills as a function of depth differential, which has some predictive parameters. So all that said, we look at this and we create our models. And then when we look at our model overall, the changes, we see that we have some improvements in our model in characterizing the hazard, right? So the dashed line that you see, the dotted line, is the old model for the blue, which is shallow basins, the gold, which is not considering basins at all, and the green, which is the deeper, thicker basins. And what you're seeing is that our model does a better job of resolving them as we go to longer and shallower periods and longer periods, right? We don't have this wide variability because we have more data. So we've improved upon the characterization of our hazard at these for this model. And when we look at an example of, let's say, a hypothetical magnitude 7 at a distance of 10 kilometers, we look at it at Simi Valley, which is our valley site, and we see that for magnitude 7, 10 kilometers away, for a valley site, we have significant underprediction, which is the gold line, if you don't include the basin effects. The blue line is if you include basin effects. And then at long periods, we have overprediction, right? So this is showing this is your response spectrum that you would use for to determine your hazard. Now, if we look at the Port of LA, which is a basin site, we see that we have significant under prediction if you don't include our new model within your hazard estimates at long periods. There's still a little bit of short period, but at long periods you see significant influence. And I put the dashed line here just to give you a period of 4 seconds to show you how wide of a difference it is at that 4 second. And this is a log scale. And then you have the downtown LA. Downtown LA is the basin edge, and you have some amplification there, not as much, but there is amplification going on there. And in the mountain hill, there's the amplification of the ground motion there. This is San Gabriel Mountains, as you see. So this is just showing you the efficacy of our model when you include it and you don't include it, right? So now we're going to talk about the variability of the site terms. And this variability essentially is, we're trying to see how much knowing being in the basin affects your variability. And why the variability is important, because the variability is essentially what controls your hazard and your probabilistic seismic hazard analysis, right? So if you have a smaller variability, your hazard is going to be less. If you have a larger variability, you're going to have a significant hazard. So let's see what happens. Now, before we do our analysis, what we have to do is we have to show that we're not doing crazy stuff. So we have to, the gold line here that you see here is the site to site variability that was computed for the former AJ-West2 data set, global data set, right? So you have that, the variability from having all the sites together. The green line is the AJ-West2 data set, but just for that Southern California region that we're looking at. And we see that it's still, it's close, but a little less than the global data set, which makes sense because if you're using a global data set and you use a subset of the data set, you should reduce your variability because you're using a smaller subset. Now, when we look at our data, because now we're looking at the same Southern California as the green line, but we've added more data. So now we further reduce the variability. And that makes sense because, you know, we have similar shapes, but it reduced variability. So this gives us confidence that we know that our analysis makes sense and we're not doing something crazy. So now that we've done that, we've verified that, we want to look at what is it going to be look like when we look at just the basin components of it. And that's what this plot is showing here. The gold line that you see are the basin sites. The purple line that you see are the non-basin sites. And what you will notice is that on average, when you look at the basin sites, you have lower variability in basin sites. So if you know that you're in a basin, your variability from site to site is much lower. Versus if you're on a mountain hill, your variability is actually higher than average. And this makes sense because, you know, on the mountain hill, we have significant amount of different effects that maybe may not be accounted for properly, the topographic effects, discontinuities, and the likes. And the basins, maybe, you know, we speculate and we're still investigating, but the fact that the basins are having, we have less variability geologically than the mountains, you have a little bit less variability in the response to ground motions. The valley sites, you can see, are smaller basins, have lower variability as well, but as you get to higher periods, that bump in variability is more so due to reduction of data, because at longer periods, we kind of have a reduction in the data set because of science limitations. But essentially, what you're seeing is that overall, you have lower variability for these basin locations. And that's very, very important. So just to summarize, the amplification contribution, when we look at all the data combined, the amplification contribution that we see there that's highlighted in the red circle is primarily from basins, coastal basins, and the mountain hills. And the amplification that we're getting overall, which is about 0.25, 0.3, is reduced compared to NJ West 2, which is about 0.5. So because we have more data, we're doing a better job characterizing our hazard. The gradient that we have, the scaling with delta Z, is from pretty much every category except for those inland basins, so those shallower basins, like San Gabriel, Chino Basin, San Bernardino Basin. So we looked at those and we saw that those they have an offset, so they have amplification, but they have no scaling. So it's essentially what it's telling you, the data that we have is not enough to resolve what's actually going on in those areas. So we have to give it kind of an average as well. And then the deamplification that we see when we combine all the data, which is what the previous basin model had, is that the deamplification is not from the coastal basin, not from the deep basins, right? And the deamplification also is reduced compared to what was in NJ-West 2. So if you remember in the previous plot, I showed you that deamplification kept on going, which is not the case when we look at the data, right? There's a plateau and reduction in deamplification. So looking at future research, one thing that we're going to be looking at is we're going to expand this to other areas. We did this for Southern California, but we're going to be going to Seattle, Bay Area, Utah, you know, we're going on a tour, you know, so keep an eye out in the city near you. So we're going to be coming for you guys as well. we also need to perform analysis on the path effects and its relation to the site response. So azimuthal effects in basin, whether the earthquake is underneath the basin or far from the basin, does that affect how stuff is looking at it? There's been works that did that before, but now that we have more data, we want to look back at those types of investigations. We also want to investigate a statistical approach to essentially categorizing the geologic features. So I told you guys a lot about how these sites were categorized into basins and non-basins. But essentially what we're looking at is that was done using the panel of experts and subjective analysis with geomorphology and topographic relief. We've finished currently a work to essentially quantify and give you a probability of being in the basin, not in the basin. And that, look out for that paper. That paper should be coming out maybe in the next 6 to 7 months. We're going to be submitting that pretty soon. And then we're going to incorporate it into standard practice. So we're working with USGS to try and incorporate this into the next National Seismic Hazard Map. So we'll see how that goes so that we can essentially incorporate this model into standard practice so that it can be used for work in LA and all over the world, primarily LA. A lot of the structures that we have in LA that are being built have to consider all these basin effects. unless you're going to significantly over design your structure, you have to consider these basin effects. So, you know, the big stadiums, the high rises, these are important structures that essentially have to incorporate these types of analysis into them. So to end, I want to essentially thank the people that funded me. Without these people, I would not be able to do this stuff, and I wouldn't be able to feed my kids and my family. So I would thank Pacific Earthquake Research Center, Earthquake Engineering Peer, Caltrans, funding me, Southern California Earthquake Center, SCEC, USGS, the CGS, NSF for funding me. I also want to thank my collaborators, John Stewart, Scott Brandwell, Yusuf Brazoria, which were my former postdoc advisors, Feng-Fei Wang, who's a colleague now, UCLA colleague now at Old Dominion as a faculty, Grace Parker, also a former UCLA colleague now at USGS, same with Shad Adi, Victor Contreras, who's also now a professor at UDP in Chile, and Paulo Zimaro, who's now a professor at Calabria, and Tristan Buckley, who just finished his PhD at UCLA. And I also want to thank Rob Graves and Christine Goulet, Phil Magling, Kevin Milner, Scott Callahan. These are all the people that, and many more, who helped me along the way in my research. So I want to thank them and then take the time for questions.
Buka, that was a great presentation, some fascinating information. And so thank you very much. I'll put my applause sound effect in play for all of us here.
Thank you.
That's the only thing about these virtuals is you don't have this audience for you in the background, right?
Of course. I'm imagining I'm imagining everything in my head.
Yeah. While we wait for some questions to come in, I'm kind of excited to get some of my own in, if you don't mind.
Awesome. Please.
Great. I was thinking, you know, we had the Northridge earthquake event up in the San Fernando Basin area. And as a result of that, you know, this whole issue of basin effects became much more pronounced and aware as a result of the behavior that we saw there. Yet, meanwhile, here we are in the LA Basin, very large basin, very deep basin, and we essentially continue to ignore the basin effect for the vast majority of sites we're dealing with. And your research sounds like we should be backwards from that. Like, you know, it shouldn't be such a big deal to be concerned with the basin effects in, say, a small basin, relatively small basin like San Fernando versus the LA Basin. So I was kind of curious to hear your thoughts about where we are on that and what would appear to be a completely backward situation with the practice.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing. You know, it's a fascinating thing when it comes to trying to implement these different findings. And usually, a lot of times, it comes down to a reactive response rather than proactive response, similar to Northridge, where, you know, things are okay and things are fine, status quo, until it's not. And then now we have to fix it. So, but the hope is that, you know, the National Seismic Hazard Model, essentially, it's kind of like the de facto for a lot of the code-based design engineers that we do, because people go there to get those values. So our goal is to try and incorporate this model within those values so that you have this at least embedded within those values that are used for design. So at least we capture some of that uncertainty somehow and that conservatism by incorporating into design. On the other hand, and that's just the code-based design. On the other hand, for a lot of the large major projects, you do have to consider this in your PSA chain. Now, previously, no, this work is very relatively recent, so we're working on trying to push this into the state of the practice. So the goal is eventually, in the near future, very near future, these will be things that are done on a regular basis in order to capture these basin effects. Because, as you saw, it is important, and there is variability within the basin. So some places, depending on where the earthquake is, you may have some application to LA Basin, and some earthquakes, maybe not. You know, the Northridge earthquake was interesting because in Santa Monica, you had this weird focusing effect for this, like this one block, where all the streets on this one block were like just completely damaged, and then the block over, everything was fine. No. Now it's like, you know, what do you do in those instances? And that and we're working on trying to improve upon that as well, because, you know, that those are the questions that practitioners will be asking. Okay, what do we do? Is this something that we can apply everywhere or just one place? Or, you know, how do we know? What do we know? So the goal is to try and work on that and improve that as well.
You know, living on the Pacific Ocean, I have the opportunity, of course, to watch the waves come in and the interactions, especially into a basin area, and seeing once in a while a rogue peak just pop up because of it lines up badly, right? So
exactly.
Think of it kind of aligned to that, is that you can't say it'll be on this street or that street, but you can say within a region there's an increased probability of this occurrence, right? So that's the best we can do.
Exactly.
What would you say would be a good criteria on which to say, hey, I need to be focusing on potential basin effects when you're looking at some site? And it may not be necessarily in California, right? We got we got other places in the world that have some similar situations. So when does a practitioner look at a site and say, you know, this is something I should look into deeper?
You know, that's a very good question, Dave. Really great question. You know, a lot of this is stemmed from, you know, us as geotechs. There's the geo part of our profession is actually very, very important. And the way you kind of see, and, you know, this goes back to, you know, Ralph Peck and the observational method and all things that are done. You kind of have to go and see and look on, you know, do some kind of some reconnaissance, right? So if you go somewhere and you see that this site is within this area that has a lot of soil, you know, everything's fine. But if you look on a larger scale and look at the region, you're like, hey, this kind of looks like a basin. Should we consider basin effects? Then you can start asking those questions. So if it comes down to the scale at which you look at your project. Are you looking at your project just from the local site scale? Or are you looking from the site and the regional scale? Because all those things have effects, right? So that's kind of the answer to that, to the question would be, you know, taking a step back and looking at the geology of your region and the geology of your site. And that would give you some insight into how you can essentially see if you're going to have to take into consideration basin effects or not.
Sure. Makes sense. In your study, I don't know if you filtered out these kinds of effects, but did you look at, you know, that the slope of the interface, the sides of the basin, did that come into play? Because obviously I would imagine, you know, the steepness of that contact affects it.
Yes, that's another great question. So when we were doing our analysis, we kind of lumped all the basin effects into one. Basin effects, again, is another weird thing where it actually has, as I showed earlier, a number of things. It depends on the incidence wave to your basin, how the waves come in, how far away is it underneath your basin or just adjacent to it? What's the slope of your basin contact? You know, all those things play in a factor. But when we did analysis with this analysis that we performed, everything's kind of lumped into one basin effect, right? So I'm currently working right now, actually currently as we speak, on trying to find a way to essentially separate those things. And so we can know, okay, how do edge effects come into play? Those slopes, you know, at the edges. How does it come into effect if you're in the center of the basin? Is it depend on some kind of distance? All those things play a huge factor, and that's a lot of good work that needs to be done, and it's currently being done.
And I would imagine, too, it also depended on where that earthquake source is relative to its location in the basin, right? So if I'm on the edge of the LA basin and that earthquake happens out in the Santa Monica Mountains versus south LA basin, you know, where you can have those waves travel across, hit the edge of the basin and bounce back, right? Yeah, so you get the same place, but it depended on where the earthquake was.
Yeah. So again, that's actually another thing that I'm currently working on. So all these things are wonderful questions, because these are all questions that need to be answered, and I'm currently working on them as well. Yes.
Well, maybe I'll come join you. It's fascinating. we do have a few other questions from others, because I've hogged up enough of them myself, but. Rashid is asking if what's the sensitivity of the velocity model that you develop for this? Is that going to have a big impact when you're considering this type of thing?
That's a very good question. You know, the velocity model is currently, as we speak, kind of, if you look at simulations, they play a big role, because those velocity models essentially act as the mesh that you use to run your simulation. So however your mesh is, it determines the shape of your basin. Comes important for us in the case of these empirical models. The impacts that the velocity models have is that they help us for the location that we don't have measurements of basin depths. We get empirical estimates of that basin depth. So depending on the resolution of the model, velocity model will determine what the depth of that basin depth it tells you, and whatever that basin depth it tells you goes back into the model to essentially help you either develop or estimate your site response. So that's kind of the sensitivity. There is a little bit of sensitivity depending on the model, but the more the models are improved, and those models are pretty good, the more the models improve, the better we get at also resolving our site. And then also the other thing is to measure it. We have to do measurements. And the only difference is that some of those measurements are kind of hard, because, you know, nobody's going to be sitting there drilling holes to about a kilometer deep. It's kind of crazy. So
there's some practical considerations there.
Yeah.
Natalie is asking about soil structure interaction factors here. So again, when you're dealing with a basin, do you have to consider a different set of soil structure considerations than you would normally do in a non-basin environment?
So that's actually that's a wonderful question. My answer to that question is more so with regards to the scale, right? So the way the soil structure interaction comes into play is that if you're looking at it from a single building, it's going to depend on the natural frequency of that building or the natural period of that building relative to the basin, right? And also depends on the earthquake, the energy of the earthquake. So that will determine if you're going to have some kind of resonance in your building, and that will determine kind of how the soil structure interaction will work out. Now, if you're looking at a spatial distribution of the hazard or clusters of buildings, then you come into play as, okay, maybe now that we have a larger footprint, that basin effect may have some relationship. If you're looking at the soil structure interaction amongst different buildings, you may have the contribution from those basin effects, and it may influence significantly those soil structure interactions. That's also something else I'm hoping to work on very soon. I can submit something very soon in regards to that. There's a lot. I know that.
Buka, hurry up, man. We need this stuff. You got to get to it.
I know a lot of my answers are coming across as I haven't done it yet, but that's just the truth. You know, it's a great idea. It's a wonderful questions, and I'm thinking about them, and I'm preparing to try and answer them. So keep just stay posted. I know it's coming. I apologize for the cliffhanger, but it's coming. It's coming. It's coming.
We understand. We appreciate that you're spending your time and energy to even pursue these areas that clearly need to be looked at for a better understanding. Jorge has asked if you tend to do any further research in the Imperial Valley Basin specifically.
Oh, yeah. The IVB, basin after my own heart. The Imperial Valley is a very, very interesting basin. We looked into that basin. There were some things that came up with that basin that were kind of interesting with regards to velocity models, particularly because things have changed and things have updated. Things were a little bit weird and wonky, but that's a very deep basin. The site response to that basin is you know, it's also significant, you know, and there's a lot of stations out there. The El Centro Array is another, you know, it's a very important one. Wildlife Array is out there. They have Garner Valley out there. There's a lot of stuff out there, but yeah, we're looking to the Imperial Valley basin. Now we did that analysis. Now, I think I showed a plot of the Imperial Valley as well. It was on that plot of the different basins. And the Imperial Valley also has significant underprediction as you go to long periods. It's actually quite significant. So yes, we are looking into that as well. And the model that we developed does incorporate the Imperial Valley in it as well.
Okay, I got one quick question that came in here. I'm trying to digest what he's saying here. It's wants to know what features of the earthquake geology or topography can be important in order to reduce the bias between observed data and the data obtained from the ground motion model in the simulation model.
I'm trying to synthesize that question.
Yeah, I know. It was a little bit of a mouthful, but essentially what he's looking at the earthquake geology and topography as factors, right? Mm-hmm. And how important they are to studying those individual effects, maybe to reduce the bias that you're getting in the study.
I see. So the question
instead might be grouping out, effects.
Yeah, the question might come down to into separating that basin effects, right? So remember, I said basin effects kind of is a compilation of different effects. It includes kind of the typical resonance from being in that large basin. You know, if the bowl of jello kind of resonates with the energy of the earthquake, then you have that basin resonance that happens there. You also have the focusing that can happen from the like a lens-like structure that kind of point all the energy into one point, particular location, like in Santa Monica during Northridge. Or do you have the edge effects where when the basin comes from the edge, then you have that, you know, the reflection that occurs due to the incidence wave and the materials. In order to decipher those different things, you have to start looking for parameters and also that are based in geologic and geomorphologic features that can essentially describe those effects.
Yeah.
So there are different ones that we're looking at, and we're looking into that as well, but there are different features. You know, people, a very interesting one that's clear cut is the angle of the basin contact, right? That's a clear cut one that we're looking at, but it makes sense because that angle is going to determine how it's going to reflect and refract, and it's going to kind of induce that surface wave, the basin edge. You know, one interesting fact is that, you know, here in downtown LA is an interesting place because it's the edge of the LA basin, but it's kind of like a cliff, actually. So if you look at, there's been some work that was done by folks in Caltech and resolving the velocity structure of that area. And what you see is instead of seeing like a typical, like a bowl, it's almost like a sharp cliff in that area. So you can imagine the edge effects in that area are going to be vastly different than what you're going to get probably like in Huntington Beach area. So that they do play a factor, and the goal is in order to resolve that is to look at those different features as well.
Yeah, and that kind of goes to the question of the geology, because there you're talking about the edge that's dictated more by a fault scarp system, right? Opposed to eroded or other formational geomorphology effects, right?
Exactly.
Well, great. Well, you certainly have a huge body of data. You've got all kinds of sites to do. So I can imagine this is going to be years and years of grinding away. And
yep.
I'm sure you're excited to do it.
Oh, yeah. It's work is a wonderful feeling. You wake up, trying to tackle this work today, trying to see what we can find, dive deep into the problem. Yeah, it's fascinating. I love it. It's great.
Got to get that feeling shared by everybody in the business. Get juiced up, right? So, Buka, thank you very much for an interesting and fascinating talk. We really enjoyed that. And so thank you. We'll turn this back over to Brad for close.
Yeah. Thank you guys for having me. I really, really appreciate it. You know, it's a wonderful opportunity to present my work, and I'm really thankful for the opportunity. So thank you guys.
It was great to have you, Buka. I didn't put my other earbud in. You guys can still hear me, though, because the mic's in the right spot. And great job, Dave. And thanks to all of our viewers who asked questions today. It's always a little bit richer when we get that interactivity and people are asking questions. So as I mentioned at the top of the show, this was our final live stream for 2022. We have two more in this series of Geo-Congress sneak previews coming up, one in January and one in February. So look out for those. Of course, we'll be back next year with GeoStrata Extra and our recorded series, Geo Legends and Director's Cut and Field Trips and all that good stuff too. So keep your eyes peeled. If you liked what you saw today, you probably did because you're here at the end. You should click like, subscribe, get notifications. And of course, if you do those things, we will let you know every time we post something to our YouTube channel. So with all that out of the way, I will give one final thank you to Buka and Dave for their hard work today. And for our viewers, thanks for sticking with us all year. And we will see you... well, soon, I guess. Happy holidays from GI, and thanks to everyone for staying involved. Have a great day.
Sister a cuddly toy. We don't want a jigsaw or a monopoly money. We only want